Did you know there's an organ in our bodies carrying out over 500 vital functions? This is your liver, the chemical factory of your body, tirelessly detoxifying your blood, storing essential vitamins, and metabolizing your food into energy. But what happens when this mighty organ is pushed to its limits? When the very power to regenerate is compromised? That's where our story of today begins. Welcome to our overview of a disease that tests the limits of our liver's resilience, liver cirrhosis. The liver is an unpaired organ located in our abdominal cavity, just below the right side of the rib cage. It is the largest gland in the human body, weighing approximately 1.5 kilograms. The liver works synchronously with many other organs and contributes to the maintenance of basic physiological functions of the body. To name a few, the liver stores energy molecules, produces bile, helping to digest fats, processes and detoxifies alcohol, medication, and toxins from the blood, and produces proteins necessary for blood clotting. On the inside, the liver's main cells are called hepatocytes, which translated from Latin literally means liver cells. These cells carry out all the functions of the liver. Hepatocytes are arranged into these hexagonal lobules, which are bounded by the supporting cells and connective tissue. These lobules are the functional units of the liver. When the liver is injured for any reason, it results in the loss of hepatocytes. But given their ability to regenerate, they quickly multiply and restore the architecture of the lobules. However, in certain cases, the injury is filled with scar tissue, also called fibrous tissue. The proliferation of the scar tissue actually results in the loss of the functional tissue of the liver, and in this case cannot be recovered. Knowing this is important for further understanding of cirrhosis. The liver is a special organ, also in the sense that it receives more venous blood than arterial blood. This venous blood comes via the portal vein, which carries blood from the gastrointestinal tract, filled with metabolites and everything else absorbed into the intestines. All right, now you're all set with need-to-know information, which will make it easier for you to understand cirrhosis. Liver cirrhosis is the end stage of many chronic liver diseases. This means that cirrhosis cannot develop overnight, but rather as a result of a long-term disease and develops over time. Cirrhosis is most frequently associated with long-term alcoholism, hepatitis B and C, as well as non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. It can also result from some metabolic disorders that cause the deposition of minerals in the liver, such as hemochromatosis, iron deposition, and Wilson disease, copper deposition. Not every person with these conditions will develop cirrhosis. Upon any injury, the liver will constantly try to repair itself. The regenerative capacity of the liver fades slowly, leading first to progressive scarring or liver fibrosis, which only in later stages manifests as cirrhosis. Since the scar tissue is not flexible, its formation leads to creation of constrictive bands around and across the hepatic lobes. This increases the pressure in the associated blood vessels coming from the hepatic portal vein, which leads to a condition called portal hypertension. In addition, the bile ducts that convey the bile from the liver may get pressured as well, leading to the holding of bile in the liver, which is called bile stasis. Bile stasis leads to exposure to the destructive effects of bile and further destruction of the liver tissue. At the same time, the remaining hepatocytes try to regenerate the functional tissue, but the constrictive force of scar tissue leads to the development of nodules. Ultimately, a healthy liver looking like this is transformed into a mass of regenerative nodules surrounded by fibrous bands. The symptoms and signs of liver cirrhosis depend greatly on the stage of the disease, varying to almost no symptoms at all the way to liver failure. The early stages of cirrhosis are usually asymptomatic. As the disease progresses further, non-specific signs such as weight loss, anorexia, and weakness might start showing. The swelling of the liver, called hepatomegaly, can cause abdominal pain, often described as dull, aching, and causing a sensation of fullness. Bile stasis can result in jaundice, which shows as yellow discoloration of the skin and of the white of the eyes. Jaundice also induces a persistent itch on the skin, called pruritus, sometimes so serious that patients tend to scratch their skin raw. Patients may also experience intestinal symptoms such as diarrhea or even constipation. Since the liver is the central organ for proper estrogen metabolism, impaired liver function results in elevated levels of estrogen. The consequences of this are especially visible in male patients, resulting with atrophy of the testicles and enlargement of the breasts called gynecomastia. In both sexes, increased estrogen leads to development of notable rashy redness of the palms called palmar erythema, as well as dilations of small blood vessels just under the skin, which look like red moles, called spider angiomas. The portal hypertension makes it difficult for the blood from the gastrointestinal tract to pass through and get processed in the liver. Increased pressure in this venous system leads to fluid getting accumulated in the abdomen and producing notable abdominal swelling called ascites. The late manifestations of cirrhosis are related to further complications of portal hypertension and liver cell failure. Portal hypertension leads to blood being directed via portosystemic shunts in order to bypass the liver. These shunts are the connections between the portal venous system and other bodily veins. They enable the blood to flow, but by bypassing the liver, neither the nutrients nor the toxins get properly processed. Since the shunts are not made for carrying the whole portal circulation, the blood shunting leads to enlargement of the veins in the esophagus, rectum, and abdomen, leading to the development of venous varices in these regions, called esophageal varices, hemorrhoids, and caput medusa respectively. Varices have very thin walls prone to rupture, which can cause massive internal bleeding. Since the liver produces proteins needed for blood clotting, their absence in liver cirrhosis can make this bleeding fatal quickly. Bypassing the liver also leads to increased concentration of various toxins in the blood, like ammonia. This has a toxic effect on the functioning of the brain, leading to a condition called hepatic encephalopathy. The symptoms can range from mild to severe. In the early stages, there are subtle changes in thinking, behavior, and coordination. Mood swings, irritability, and sleep problems can occur. As it worsens, confusion, disorientation, difficulty speaking and understanding, slurred speech, jerky movements, and tremors may appear. In advanced stages, there is severe confusion, personality changes, and even loss of consciousness. Immediate medical attention is crucial in these cases. If 80 to 90% of the functional liver tissue is damaged, cirrhosis usually complicates with liver failure, which presents with a failure of multiple organ systems that can lead to death unless urgently treated. Long-term liver cirrhosis can also cause hepatocellular carcinoma, which is one of the types of liver cancer. Cirrhosis is diagnosed by reviewing the medical history of a patient and conducting blood tests towards identifying whether they have any of the underlying diseases that promote cirrhosis. Then, blood tests aimed at reviewing liver function, such as those for the products of bile, blood clotting factors, platelets, and liver-specific enzymes, are conducted. This is paired with scans of the liver that include ultrasound, CT, and MRI. The final diagnosis is made by liver biopsy. In this procedure, a needle is inserted into the liver in order to take a tissue sample. A pathologist examines the sample under a microscope and confirms whether the liver is cirrhotic or not. If cirrhosis is confirmed, the patient is then sent to a medical specialist focused specifically on liver disease called a hepatologist. In the majority of cases, liver cirrhosis is irreversible. This is why treatment mostly consists of mitigating the complications and preventing the cirrhosis from progressing any further. The biggest focus is usually on treating the most urgent complications, such as hepatic encephalopathy, but also the initial cause of cirrhosis. Any dietary habits that can worsen the cirrhosis, such as alcohol consumption, are advised to be stopped. Patients with advanced cirrhosis are often candidates for a liver transplant. Besides the stage of the disease, some countries impose additional criteria for transplantation eligibility, such as the cause of the liver failure, usually making patients with alcoholic cirrhosis ineligible. Prevention of cirrhosis relates to eliminating the exposure to the factors that might induce it. Primarily, these include limiting alcohol consumption. In the UK, the official guidelines recommend not drinking more than 14 units of alcohol per week. Next is protection from hepatitis B and C. Hepatitis B is usually transmitted by blood and other body fluids, while hepatitis C is usually transmitted by blood.
This means that a person can get hepatitis B by having unprotected sex with someone infected by it. Both hepatitis B and C can be contracted by getting into contact with the blood of an infected person, by sharing a needle, or by other means.
The prevention for hepatitis B consists of avoiding unprotected sex and using condoms, as well as receiving a vaccine against hepatitis B. As of 2023, there's no vaccine for hepatitis C, so the prevention mostly consists of avoiding getting in contact with infected blood. Since obesity can lead to non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, which is a condition that can lead to cirrhosis, maintaining optimal weight and having healthy dietary habits is a good method of prevention in this case. And that's it for today. See you in the next one and stay healthy. This video is a part of Kenhub's limited clinical series and is for educational purposes only. It does not provide medical advice and none of the information in this video should be used as an alternative to a medical exam, specialist diagnosis, nor treatment. If you're feeling any health disorder symptoms, please contact your doctor.